Welcome to a special bonus browser episode where I talk to playwright, director, and comics creator and writer, Sean Lewis. In my conversation with Sean, we delve into the creative side of comics. I ask him about artist-writer collaborations, inspirations for his characters, and about his latest book, Thumbs. We finish up by talking about what projects he has coming soon. Enjoy. Start off with one. I don't know if many of your comic readers realize that you are also a filmmaker and a director and a playwright. Do those different kind of mediums and forms of expression, do they inform each other at all, or do you kind of, are they in their own boxes? Do you look at them as totally separate?
No, they definitely inform. I mean, there's little differences between them for sure. Like, I was working on a comic book script today and I was having trouble with a scene, and I actually just was like, okay, I'm going to approach this as if it were a play.
Yeah.
In the sense of, when I write a play, I just write dialogue first before I think about any of the visuals. I'm just like, what are they saying to each other? What's the actual textual story? And then there's times where I've found myself writing plays now where I'm like, this scene is a mess, or like, this is really boring. I need to think about this as a filmmaker or as a comic book writer. And then I'll approach it and I'll be like, well, what if I just wrote out all the actual visual things we see, right? Like, that's the biggest difference between the two of them, is I would say, like, with comic books, a lot of times when I write a comic book, I will write a page for page, panel for panel script without any dialogue. It's all just visual images, and I'll send a lot of visual reference. Like, I'll be sending photographs and drawings to the artist. Where with a play, a lot of times, like, I don't even write stage directions in a first draft. I'm just writing what everyone's saying to each other. And then a screenplay is somewhere in the middle. Like, it's kind of the perfect marriage of both. It's the hardest out of the three for me, because I think it takes both sides of the brain, where I'm like, oh, I have to think of how incredibly visual I can make this, but also I have to make the dialogue move the story along at the same time, which drives me nuts.
So your process, you kind of start very visually in terms of comic books. You think about, like, paneling and everything to start with?
It kind of depends on the artist. Like, the artist I'm working on with this book right now, he said right from the beginning, can you give me panel by panel breakdowns? Where then, like, somebody like Caitlin, who I do Coyotes with, the way we work together is really different because she comes from animation. So the scripts I give her will be a little bit closer to animation scripts. Mm-hmm. Or closer to a screenplay. Hayden, who I do The Few and Thumbs with, his understanding of comics and visual design and motion is just beyond, so much beyond mine, that a lot of times what I do with him, and he honestly prefers, is like, with him I almost write like short stories. Mm-hmm. And I just am like, you translate it into something else. So like, it's kind of figuring out the collaboration with it. It's funny, it takes so much time to do it panel for panel visually on my end. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, what you get back is not at all like what you wrote. Not in a bad way. It's always better. Mm-hmm. But it's like, I'm not a visual artist. So like, invariably they rethink it and they're like, oh, actually I could do an aerial shot there. This should be a two-page spread and I'll get that back. And I'm like, oh, I'm just kind of trying to, I think as a comic book writer, you're kind of like, you're trying to inspire the best work from your artist, whatever that means. So a lot of times with comic book artists, I start by asking them, I'm like, how do you want scripts? Like, how do you want to do this? Because your work is going to drive the book.
My next question was actually about your collaboration with these artists, because you've worked with such distinctive artists, I'd say. How did you come to these artists? Were they, I tried to imagine the different books with different artistic styles, and it was very hard for me to do. And it seemed like they fit the project so well. How intentional, I guess, is that?
Oh, that's completely intentional. Yeah. Like, each of those projects were written specifically for the artist. I knew their work, or I was working on a project already. When I saw their art, I was like, oh, you're the right person. And then it helped. And then the project actually would change once they come in, because I would start to learn what they're capable of doing even further, and going like, okay, I need to rethink how we do this. So Saints was the first comic I did, and I met Ben because I was in Iowa City, and he was also in Iowa City. He was an undergrad. I was running a theater company, and I hired him to do animations for a play we were doing to be projected. And all the drawings he was doing were like these Silver Age Superman DC comics. And so I started talking to him about it. I was like, are you a comic book fan? He was like, yeah. And it turned out he's actually not that practicing in religion, but he had taught himself how to draw by looking at old religious paintings. I grew up heavily Catholic, like deeply Irish, first generation Irish Catholic. So the lives of the saints was huge. So we started talking and we were just like, what if saints were the X-Men? Like what would happen if that was a book? Once that book finished, I didn't know how you found artists. I was working at Image and I asked them, because me and Ben came as a team, and I was like, oh, can you put me together with artists? And they were like, we don't do that. You got to find your own. And so weirdly enough, I found a Facebook page that was a like artists and writers, comic book artists and writers meetup. And I found both Hayden and Caitlin's portfolios on there on the same day. Wow. And I had had a first script of The Few that I had written, and I had a first script of Coyotes that I had written. I wrote both of them out of nowhere and was like, here's a script. I think you'd be great for this book, and I think you'd be great for this book. If you want to collaborate, like read the scripts and just let me know. And luckily, both of them got back and were like, let's do this. This sounds really cool. You know, with Coyotes, I knew I wanted to do something that was a bit like really mythic, a touch of Neil Gaiman in it. And like I knew it was going to have an emotive quality, and Caitlin's art was perfect for it.
I'll tell you, I mean, what, like her characters are, they seem to tell a story in every single frame. Just like the expressions and the kind of body posing is so, it's so expressive.
Part of that is Kate's kind of crazy. Mm. Like the way she draws every single panel is she does her own personal photo reference. So she hires models and she poses them and takes photographs, or she takes photographs of herself. And then that's how she draws the book. So it's really time consuming and painstaking. Like Coyotes takes when I work with Kate, cause we have a new book that we're putting out when comic books come back. and she's doing it the same way. It's just our books. When I work with Kate, it takes a much longer time just because the style and the ways that she works is that intensive. But like you said, like for Coyotes, like just the way the eyes and the face and the body tell so much story, I was like, that's what we need for this thing to work. And with Hayden, I was really interested in, The Few. I was like, I really want to do a hyperkinetic story that can be really quiet, like a sci-fi, like a dystopic story that's also quiet, because it so rarely is. And I saw his art, and I was like, wow, there's a real energy and movement to his paneling. But he also has this great, like, sketchy style, like really fast, harsh. It's really harsh and mean, kind of. and it just kind of, for The Few, it was perfect. And then when we did Thumbs, like I turned to him and we'd had such a good collaboration. He was going like, well, let's do another book. Like me and him are actually on our third book right now. We're like halfway through doing the next one. But it's always just turned into like, what world do you want to draw next? Or what story are you interested in?
I want to dig into Thumbs just a little bit more. When I picked it up and first started reading and kind of read the blurb on the back, I kind of thought I was getting into a story that, and it does think through the relationship of technology and a technological society with human well-being. And I was kind of waiting for a concise message about that relationship. But as I was reading on, I realized like the story you were developing was a lot more complex. It wasn't just a bunch of technologists pitted against a bunch of nostalgic utopians. Did you want your readers to come away with a particular message?
Yeah. You know, I think, I think my writing career has been very much this way. People either really like this about my writing or it drives them very insane because I don't think I often have a very like, here is your walk away message of the book. And I, as my wife says, she's like, you never also write just a good guy or a bad guy. There's almost always this third entity that things bounce off of, a third faction. And I think a big thing for me is I think the one takeaway that probably shows up in all of my work is I'm really obsessed with belief and the fervency of belief. Like I don't understand. Part of it is I think I'm either weirdly agnostic or atheist about a lot of things. Like I feel very confused and overwhelmed a lot of time with the world. So I'm like, I don't know what I believe in because everyone's shouting so loud and making such interesting points. I don't know what to do. And so, like, I feel like within the writing, I'm constant. And I guess that's also, I get scared. I get really scared by absolutism. Like, I'm very scared by people who are just like, this is correct and this is wrong. So actually people who do come out and they're just like, technology is evil and we need to get rid of it. I'm like, well, don't you like hot water? Like, doesn't that count? Like, where does absolutism like stop, you know? And the flip of it is people who are like, technology is the absolute best. There should be no restraints on it. I'm like, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, like, saints had to do with that with religion. The few had to do with it with like really like partisan politics. The thumbs obviously has to do with it with technology. I think at the end in both, like for thumbs specifically, I'm like, at the end, everyone is trying to figure out how to connect with human beings. It's just some people think that they can only do it now through the technology. And then the flip of it is people who are like, technology took everything from me. And so the only response I have to it is this. Like, because some people read it and they were like, I was really hating the power. And then like you go to like issue 2 or 3 and I'm like, I agree with the power.
Yeah.
Come on. Everything they're saying makes sense to me. And I'm like, I'm glad you're angry. I'm sad you're not going to continue buying the book. Because like that wasn't a mistake. That's literally the goal. Like, a lot of these genres, I personally get a little bit bored because I think like I watch a lot of sci-fi movies and it sets it up so definitively as here's the good guys and here's the bad guys. I'm like, why am I watching the rest of the movie? Actually, it's funny. Like, I learn a lesson at the end of the movie, but I rarely learn anything else.
Yeah.
And it's not making me actually analyze thought. It's just going like, hope saves the universe. And I'm like, I kind of already thought that.
I want to talk about the one you were talking about, like human connection and these very, very human traits. I want to talk about the one character in Thumbs who is not a human, but goes by the name of Mom. And Mom is one of the more interesting, unique characters I've read recently. Like, can you give us any insight into the development of Mom and like some of the choices that you made with that character?
Sure. Mom was the first character that was created for that book. That was the impetus for the entire book. Usually there's like a single character who shows up and starts talking and I'm like, oh, okay, I have something to build everything else around. So for people who haven't read the book, Mom is basically like an AI babysitter who grows really powerful, meaning that like a Mark Zuckerberg type character has realized that poor people who can't maybe afford daycare or other things can't afford an app. And so he creates this app that kind of creates this basically like AI hologram-esque babysitter that can watch your kids while you're at school, which I have a young son. I would sign up probably for this app, especially now, man. And I got kind of fascinated by the idea of it. Is I'm like, oh, like because my initial idea was that even as a parent, I'm like, I would sign up for that. And then there was a part of me that was like, that's horrifying that I would sign up for that, that I would sign up for a piece of technology to raise my child. And also like all the things we know now about like Facebook and analytic, like what would it be teaching my child? Like what information would be coming through and who would be controlling this entity? And so I got really obsessed. I mean, deep down, I am always going to be a myth nerd. Like I love myth. And so like every book has to kind of find its myth. You know, a lot of times I steal from the Bible. Saints was obviously from the Bible, but even the few has like a couple of biblical characters who show up as like modern prophets. Mm-hmm. With this, it was kind of starting from scratch and just going like stealing from a couple of different like Greek myths and going like, oh, there is the Pandora's box, right? Like it comes out, we think it's a gorgeous thing. And then Mom becomes more and more dangerous. But I also kind of really, I loved the idea of, we always talk about how we are dependent on technology and like the fear of AI and things like that. And I just started thinking, I'm like, well, at its most base, obviously technology is dependent on us, mm-hmm. right? It doesn't exist if it doesn't have a user. As the book keeps going along, the tide shifts. The user, Charlie, ends up becoming the one who's like, oh, Mom exists because of me. Like I am the entire reason that Mom is here.
It's a little unfair, I think, to ask art-based questions, but one of the most distinctive features of Thumbs was the fact that all the tech is kind of colored this bright, like very distinctive way. And I think about like most of the tech that I have in my house, and it's trying to like disappear almost. It just blends in. My baby daughter's like Sound Machine monitor looks like a little decorative vase, and my TV is getting flatter and flatter as if it's like wanting to become the wall, right? And on the other hand, in Thumbs, we have all the technology is very remarked upon just by its color. It's very distinct.
I mean, that decision came directly from Hayden.
Okay.
You know, Hayden at one point, well, again, it's how you inspire each other. Like, Hayden very astutely, like, I sent the first script on to him, and he started messing around with sketches, and he wrote back, and he was like, okay, here's what I'm thinking color scheme. He was like, I think it'll be kind of muted, but every time they're dealing with technology, I think I'm going to have, like, neon, like, bright purple, bright pink, like, really loud. And it made perfect sense to me because I was like, what you're saying is incredibly true and is something that I had been thinking about with this, of like, technology is not only just becoming ubiquitous in our life through use, but through design. Like, I think it's designed unobtrusively, so we add more and more of it to our life without realizing we've added so much of it.
Yes.
And so, like, it becomes this background of life. And I was like, oh, he's inverting it. He's going, what if the human beings start to become the background of the tech? Right? So the tech is the loud, bright stuff, and it's the human beings in the background who are always gray. And, oh, what if it's the human beings that are fading away as the technology is now becoming more prevalent? The very next book I've got coming out is a book called Bliss, which is with Caitlin.
Okay.
Which is kind of like a Neil Gaiman. It's kind of like they're selling it as American Gods meets Breaking Bad. So it takes like the myth of the River Lith, the goddess of oblivion, and marries it to like the opioid crisis, where there's people taking this drug that makes them cry or sweat, and the water drips into the ground and it funnels back to this goddess. And so like and it keeps going from there. Like she's involved with the human world, and so she becomes a crime boss with a human hitman. We follow the human hitman as he's going through that world. Hayden and I are doing a Western. I don't know when we finished 3 issues of it. I don't know when it'll come out. Everything's a little up in the air right now. And then I'm doing a space opera with a company called Vault Comics that was scheduled for September. I think it'll still happen in the fall. And then it looks like there's a comic company called 12 Gauge who does a lot of more pulpy books, who they kind of commissioned me to make this like Red Dawn meets 30 Days of Night type book. It was an amazingly busy year until the world went crazy.
That's great, Sean. Hey, I really appreciate the time and keep writing, keep busy. We look forward to seeing what's next.
I hope I get the opportunity to. It's a crazy, crazy moment.
Okay, thanks a lot, Sean. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, take care.
Take care.